Took a little while.
Hello and welcome to Abby Tyler's Healthy Living. My name is Abby Tyler. I'm your host, a family nurse practitioner, a health and wellness blogger, and a community volunteer. In here, we discuss evidence-based health information regarding mind, body, and soul with a holistic emphasis. Thanks for joining me on this journey of health and wellness. Please enjoy the show.
Hey, hello, hello, hello. Welcome to Abby Tyler's Healthy Living. My name is Abby Tyler. I'm your host. You guys know I said today's we're talking about heart health, and I have a cardiologist with me today. You can see it's Dr. Coca. So we'll start off by saying, please share the show. Please share the show. Invite your friends, everybody else too. And a disclaimer, of course, we're providers, but we're not your provider. So please do not make any changes to your regimen without speaking to your own provider. Okay. So with that being said, let's get started. I'm going to be going to the questions. Leave your questions and we can answer them. Okay. Nothing too personal because you have to talk to your own doctor first. Okay. So there we are today. Without any further ado, we're going to I will turn to Dr. Coca. Can you please introduce yourself and just say a little bit about yourself, what you do in the community and job and all that?
Yeah. So my name is Dr. Coca. I'm a cardiologist. I have a practice in Center City, Philadelphia. I trained at Temple for medical school, Temple for residency, and I went to Thomas Jefferson, right in Center City for cardiology. And I opened up a practice right next door to Jefferson. So that's where my practice is. And I'm a preventative cardiologist. I'm super interested in trying to prevent heart attacks. We have amazing technology to deal with heart attacks when they happen. But of course, the best heart attack is the one that you don't have. So we try to focus on making sure people don't have heart attacks. And we also focus on vascular health, trying to see what we can do to help reduce the risk of a future stroke too. A heart attack is the number one cause of death, starting, I think, around age 40 or so for both men and women. And then stroke is number three. So both of them are kind of in my a little bit in my ballpark because so much of heart health has to do with vascular health, and vascular health is so important for strokes as well. So.
Okay. So somebody may be asking me, because as you guys know, I'm a primary care provider and I see people in the office. We do screening and we do preventative care also. I take care of people if they have high blood pressure and other heart ailments, prescribe medication, but there are times where when the situation becomes too complex, I need to send patients outside of my scope. By law, I have to refer the patient outside my scope of practice to a cardiologist. So Dr. Coca, please tell us, why should somebody, if sometimes I have patients that say, wait a second, my doctor, the other doctor I had before took care of everything. Why do I need to see a cardiologist and all that? Yeah. So why should I go see that?
Yeah, that's a great question. There are certain things. It's just, I think there's a lot of different it's important to play, as a team, because, I think you get a lot farther with a team-based approach than you do trying to do everything yourself. And, primary care is such a difficult thing, because you're kind of addressing everything, right? If the patient has some depression and anxiety, you have to spend some time talking to them about that. And if they have questions about their prostate, that's in your scope as well. And so there's just a very long list of things that, that a primary care has to deal with. And I think when things get a little more complex, so say somebody's on a blood pressure medication and the blood pressure is still out of control and you've tried one or two different medicines, at that point, it's not that I think there's a lot of primary care folks I think could go ahead and keep managing it, but man, that is so super time consuming, right? So it helps to like get a little assist and do a tag team and say, all right, I've worked a little bit on this and now let's get a cardiologist who, if anyone asks me about the prostate, I say, hey, talk to Dr. Tyler. So I can just focus in on the high blood pressure stuff. And we just, we have a lot of resources at our disposal to be able to just focus in on that. So same thing applies for, coronary disease, right? Once you have, say, you send somebody for a screening test and you see some calcification somewhere in the aorta, right? The question is, well, what do you do next with that? And then sometimes those answers are well enough answered just through the primary care doc. But other times, definitely if the patient's having some symptoms, of some chest discomfort, maybe, or some shortness of breath, or some weird gnawing pain in that epigastrium, then maybe, you know, the cardiologist, maybe you need to send them to a cardiologist to do further testing to see whether or not they have a blood flow problem that could be serious and life-threatening. So I think, you know, accessing that next level where, you know, you've done a bunch of basic platform stuff that's very good, but now you want to see, okay, do they have a blockage in the artery of the heart? That stuff that is generally speaking is outside the scope of primary care. And that's where, you know, we're more than happy to take the ball or take the baton and take go from there.
Okay. So when somebody comes over to you, right, how would you describe, like, let's say if I send patient over to you, because I'm talking to the audience too, so I'm trying to make sure that people understand that. Let's say if I send somebody to a cardiologist and they're afraid, oh my God, this must be something wrong with me if she's sending me to a cardiologist. Or sometimes you also have to see patients after hospital, post discharge from the hospital and all that too. So how would like a general visit go if somebody comes to you?
It really, a lot of it depends on what the patient's coming to see us for. You know, if the patient's coming to see us because they're passing out, you know, that sets us down a different kind of diagnostic and therapeutic pathway versus if the patient's coming because they're having some type of chest discomfort and we're looking for coronary blood flow issues. So it's really about what the presenting complaint is. I mean, generally though, a lot of times I'll see patients because they have a strong family history or because they have some risk factors for coronary disease and, you know, they want to be seen to see, okay, am I doing everything we can possibly do? And you know, those, so some basic tests to look to see, to screen for cardiovascular diseases, and then electrocardiogram. Sometimes you need an echocardiogram if the patient's having some symptoms, right? Like if somebody has, gets short of breath going up a flight of steps, right? And say they're 65 and they're diabetic, right? And they say, you know what? I just don't know. I mean, when I was 64, I could do this fine. And now it just feels like I'm hitting this wall. And I don't know why this is happening. I think those are places where you need to do a little bit more of a cardiac evaluation to be like, what is going on? Could it be anything going on with the heart that's causing this rather than just dismissing it as, you know, hey, I'm just getting older? Because of course, you know, coronary disease also gets more and more prevalent as you get older too. And so that's very, very hard to sort out just based on history sometimes. So especially if there are a lot of risk factors, if there's a family history of premature coronary disease, we'll do some advanced diagnostic testing like echocardiograms, which is an ultrasound of the heart to look at the heart muscle, see if the valves are okay, see if the heart functions okay. You know, and then depending on what that shows, maybe even do a stress test where we put them on a treadmill and have them walk on the treadmill to see what's going on within the heart itself. So I think, you know, it's a lot of testing or a lot of different pathways to go down, but those are some kind of basic paths that we go down.
Okay. So be asking questions like it's about my patient now. So, okay, so you say you go to EKG. That's the one where they just describe EKG and all that.
Yeah, EKG is really cool. I mean, it was invented in the early 1900s in Germany by a guy named Eindhoven. And the early EKGs were you had patients had to put their feet in buckets of water in order to get an EKG because you were trying to figure out electrically what was going on in the body because there were the heart, you know, is this beautiful muscle that's constantly contracting. And the way it contracts is because electricity is coursing down and through the heart muscle constantly. We can actually track that electrical current by putting little electrical little stickers on the chest and actually map what those electrical vectors and currents look like. And it's one of the greatest tools that we use to this day, even though it was invented in the early 1900s, to this day, it is of primary importance to kind of sort out if there's a fundamental problem or not within the heart. We've, of course, now gone well beyond that. And now we can actually look inside the heart with an ultrasound and see what's going on within the heart. We can do stress tests. We can do heart catheterizations, cardiac CTs. But the EKG is very, very powerful.
Okay. And echocardiogram, you said ultrasound of the heart. Can you describe that also?
Yeah. We take a ultrasound. The ultrasound came about in the 1960s. It was initially used in Sweden when they would take an ultrasound, a probe where they would shoot sound and the probe would actually sit there and it would also receive sound. So sound would go out, it would bounce off structures, it would come back and hit the same receiver. So this probe and the receiver. And then based on how far away, how long it took for that sound wave to come back, you would be able to generate a little bit of a map of like what was going on, right? So that has now advanced to the point where we take an ultrasound probe, put it towards the heart and hit the heart with sound waves at a very low frequency, not dangerous or anything like that. You know, the same thing is done with babies all the time. And basically the sound waves hit the heart structures, bounce back, and they produce a beautiful image. And, you know, a bunch of computer processing. Luckily, there's some smart software people that have figured out how to process that data coming back and generate a beautiful image of the heart. So you can actually see the heart. So, you know, they didn't have, when they came up with the Superman cartoon, they didn't understand. The only way to look inside the body was with x-rays. So they came up with x-ray vision, but ultrasound is way better. So if ultrasound was around when they made Superman, Superman would have had ultrasound vision, not x-ray vision.
Okay. So when you did an echocardiogram, what exactly are you looking for? And what is a good number based on, of course, we're talking about all the other different pre-existing conditions outside of that. Is it that you're looking for and what would be a good number? Your heart's okay.
We're looking at the heart. Ultrasound is really powerful. The echocardiogram, it shows a number of different things. One fundamental thing it shows is what the heart function is like, right? And so the heart function we describe as squeezing function. We use a term called ejection fraction. And ejection fraction is what percentage of the blood that's in the heart is ejected at any given time. It's a visual estimate usually. And normal is above 50%, all right? Generally speaking, you know, most people are 60, 65%. The range of between normal and abnormal, we set at 50%. So that is a percentage that we look at, and the primary care doctors are looking at the echo reports. But the other thing the echocardiograms do is look at the valves and see how the valves are and you have four valves in the body, two major ones that are on the left side of the heart and the mitral and the aortic. And those are very, very important to take a look at anytime somebody has complaints of chest pain or shortness of breath, to make sure that the valves are not causing any of the symptoms that people are presenting with.
Okay. Also, stress tests.
Yeah.
You need a stress test. What it is that you're looking for when you do a stress test?
Stress tests, we're looking to see if there's a problem with blood flow feeding the heart. The heart has tiny little vessels. They're about 3 millimeters big, so very tiny. And that's the blood flow to the heart muscle. When you have a heart attack, the reason you have a heart attack is because those tiny little vessels get clogged up. We've developed stress tests to be able to try to figure out whether or not there's a blood flow issue within the heart or not. And so that's what stress tests end up doing.
Okay. So if the person cannot, what would be a good result to tell the person, okay, we did this and you're fine. Come back 3 months or come back 6 months, or you don't need to come back unless.
Yeah, no. Sometimes depending if they're young, they have no risk. They have no real risk factors. They have no family history. Then we'll leave them to Dr. Tyler's capable hands. All right. We think you're okay. If you have a problem, come back and see us. Otherwise, continue seeing Dr. Tyler. If you're older, if you have risk factors, all because you have one normal test doesn't mean that everything's okay. And those people, we may follow them once a year for an EKG, or, you know, trying to track to see if there's any symptoms that are changing and see if we need to adjust anything based on that.
Okay. Yeah, ready. And also, ultrasound of the carotid arteries too.
Oh yes. So ultrasound of carotid is actually a very, very interesting test. There are two, pipes, if you will, two arteries that are on either side of the neck that feed the brain. And those vessels are very easily seen. There's no bone here or anything. You can take a probe and take some gel, and you can very clearly see the carotid from all the way up by the jaw down by the clavicle. And you can see the length of it and see if there's any narrowing going on there. And that's why I was talking about number one cause of death in folks over the age of 45 is heart disease. Number three is stroke. And a lot of those strokes, certainly a sizable percentage of them, are related to plaque that's forming in these arteries up here. So it's certainly, if you hear something on an exam, that you hear a narrow sound, something called a Bruey, when we listen to the stethoscope, that's a key thing to say, hey, we should take a look at this and see if there's anything going on there to kind of prevent a stroke.
Okay, so that would be for patients that have family history of strokes and other.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's a little controversial who exactly we should screen with a carotid ultrasound. Certainly for folks that are symptomatic, meaning they've had some neurologic issues or they have some strange neurosymptoms that we're trying to pinpoint, or they've got plaque everywhere or something like that. Yeah, then, you know, it's a test that's definitely valuable.
And when you say plaque, you mean?
Yeah, plaque is a buildup of calcium within the arteries of anywhere, actually, but specifically of the carotids when we're talking about carotid plaque. So you get, what happens is you have these sticky cholesterol molecules. You know, you eat these cheesesteaks, you eat this fatty foods, they get absorbed, they float around, you know, in the vessels, in the blood. And just like, and so those blood vessels, you know, they are susceptible to these these tiny cholesterol lipid molecules sticking to the side. And when they stick to the side, over time, they turn into calcium. And so a big thing that we do, you know, we're talking about a lot of diagnostic testing, is taking a look at people's cholesterol profiles to see if there's any way we can improve the risk of, improve their risk profile.
Okay, and some of the major heart diseases, some of the major heart ailments we're talking about, usually because when I worked as a cardiac nurse on the telemetry floor, most of what we did was also congestive heart failure, which is one of the ones that, and, you know, most like frequent readmissions to the hospital. So can you tell us a little bit about congestive heart failure?
Yeah, congestive heart failure, man, that is such a tough diagnosis. And we find it, unfortunately, you know, in almost a 1 week, most cardiologists will find at least one case of heart failure on a once a week, once every 2 week basis. And it's where the heart muscle is weak. You know, I was talking about that pumping function and that ejection fraction, right? And in this particular case, that ejection fraction is below 50%, 40%, 30%, 20%, sometimes 10%. These are very, very weak hearts that are just not able to pump enough blood. And over time, those hearts get weaker and weaker and weaker, and you have a big time problem. And the issue is that sometimes you don't know that until it's really very late in the process, and then it's tougher to kind of figure what's going on. But yeah, heart failure is a major cause of morbidity, mortality, and hospitalizations. Trying to screen and figure out who's at risk for heart failure, so we can figure out why the heart is weak, and then get you on some wonderful medications now that exist that can actually reverse the weakness of the heart. That's a big deal. And so it's very, very important to screen for heart failure, depending on what symptoms patients have.
And so what would be some of the symptoms that people have?
Great question. So if you're starting to get short of breath with exertion, more so than normal, right? Not just the normal, you know, everyone getting older. That's one. The other is, noticing that your legs are suddenly blown up and filled up with fluid. The other is if you're laying flat, you get short of breath. You know, where you used to lay flat and now you got to put 3-4 pillows in. If you wake up in the middle of the night, suddenly gasping for air. These are all potential signs that there's something wrong with the heart. So it's very important if you're having new shortness of breath with exertion or worsening shortness of breath with exertion, waking up in the middle of the night short of breath, or when you lie down, you can't, you know, you have to sit up in a chair to breathe, or even if you have to put 3 or 4 pillows now, that's there could be other things. It's not only the heart. There's other things too, but that certainly the heart is one of the major concerns in that case.
Okay. So I'm just going to look in here and see some of the questions, and we just ask questions from the audience. So Tilly Brown said, what's the difference between a stroke and heart disease?
Oh, that's a very good question. So heart disease involves, usually we think about involving the heart specifically, and stroke specifically involve the brain. So strokes involve the brain, and heart disease involves the heart. So now sometimes heart disease can cause strokes. So if you have a very weak heart, or if there's certain arrhythmias of the heart, that can actually, you can form clots in the heart. And when the heart pumps, it pumps a clot into the brain and causes a stroke. So strokes you can think of as brain issues. Heart you can think of as heart disease, you know, heart-related heart issues.
Okay, so, and in that case, you have the cardiologist and the neurologist also working along with the primary care team.
Exactly. Yeah, and the goal is, of course, primary care and cardiology working together to make sure that the patient never needs to see a neurologist.
Yes. Okay, so here Iris says, what is the purpose of nuclear imaging?
Fantastic question. You have a really great audience here. Nuclear imaging is a certain subtype of stress tests where in patients specifically that can't walk on a treadmill because there's something wrong with their knees, or they have joint problems, or their spine, or they recently had surgery or something like that. And if you can't walk, then how do you do a stress test? Well, some smart people that are much smarter than me came up with an infusion of something called adenosine. Adenosine is naturally found within your body. And if you raise your adenosine levels, you simulate stress. You dilate the arteries of the heart. When you exercise, your heart needs more oxygen. In order to get more oxygen, the arteries that feed the heart muscle, they dilate. So the way they dilate is with a molecule called adenosine. And basically, nuclear imaging, nuclear stress tests, basically they involve using that molecule, some derivative of that molecule, raising those levels to dilate the arteries of the heart. And all you're doing is sitting on the exam table, you get an IV, and you get this medicine that will simulate stress. Now, in order to look and see what the difference in blood flow is, what we want to know is, okay, what is the blood flow in the heart at rest? And what is the blood flow in the heart at stress? In order to figure that out, we inject a radioactive isotope that goes to the heart muscle, and it goes all over. Everywhere there's blood flowing to the heart, it'll go. If there's not blood flowing to a certain part of the heart, the nuclear tracer won't go. And so then you can compare the two images and say, aha, I see that there's a problem here. So that's what nuclear imaging is. Nuclear imaging usually involves doing stress tests in patients that aren't able to walk on the treadmill, using a chemical that's naturally found in the body. You can do treadmill nuclear tests too, but a lot of times nuclear tests are reserved for people that aren't able to walk on a treadmill.
And it's also stress echo.
A stress echo is where you basically run people on a treadmill and do an ultrasound of their heart.
That was fun.
an exercise and at rest. So
they get your heart to a certain level and then they grab you and then put you back on the
table. Right. Exactly right. Yeah, you got to drag them, get them down real quick, and so you can take a picture before the heart rate gets too low.
And for those of us who if you have to do stress tests, the treadmill stress test, I have sometimes like do the motion sickness and all, picture on the wall.
Right.
Where you just look up in the wall and then I have to look down, because don't look down your feet because your brain, so I had to do that. It's like, so that kind of worked. And I also did my ultrasound of carotids too. So,
Look at that. Yes. You had the full thing done.
Yes, I went there and said, you know what, let me just get everything done and get rid of all that too. So let me see another question here. Lieutenant Jolie John said, what is the difference between an x-ray and an ultrasound?
Yeah, great question. X-ray is using a radioactive source to generate a bunch of radioactive emissions. Those radioactive emissions will bounce off or go through, and then you get a picture based on that. Typically, X-rays are best used in cases of bones and looking at the bones and examining the bones. And ultrasounds are used to examine soft tissues. So the heart, no bones, soft tissue. We use an ultrasound. If you want to look to see if somebody has a broken rib, you do an X-ray, because the X-rays the X-rays are best used to tell that.
Okay, so let me see another question here. Jackie Jackson said, how do you determine a mini stroke from a full stroke?
Yeah, good question again. You know, mini strokes are otherwise called what we think of. A lot of times, it's used to refer to something called TIAs, where you have a little clot that breaks off, goes to the brain, and it interrupts blood flow to a certain part of the brain for a brief period of time, okay? Luckily, thanks to whoever you believe in, that little clot breaks up and goes away, right? And now your symptoms resolve. That is what's typically referred to as a TIA, transient ischemic attack, or a mini stroke. If that clot doesn't break up and it stays there, stays stuck, and then the brain tissue that is not getting blood anymore, it dies. And when it dies, you've had a stroke. So a stroke, a full stroke, if you will, or a stroke, we say, is when brain tissue dies. A mini stroke, usually, what they mean when they say mini stroke is no brain tissue died, but there was a threat to it, right? Typically those threats, those TIAs, they shouldn't be ignored. They're a sign that a stroke is coming unless you do something. So it's very, very important for people that have transient weakness, and say suddenly you're weak and paralyzed on one side and everything's better, you shouldn't just shake it off and be like, no big deal, right? If one side of your body is weak for any amount of time, even if it gets better, you need to go see someone, right? Go see Dr. Tyler so she can direct you in where to go. If you suddenly can't speak, right? If you're like, oh, I'm trying to speak and you can't speak for 10, 15 minutes and then you're okay, right? That's not normal. That's something. So that also could be a sign of a mini stroke. So yeah, it's very, very important to recognize that mini strokes are warning signs for a full stroke.
Okay. So just to build up on that too, our Senator Fetterman. He had a stroke, and also people were saying that he just admitted himself for depression and all that.
Yeah.
Because of that, depression usually follows the heart attack or a stroke, anything that limits your ability to perform the way you used to perform before. How would you address that if you had a patient that's coming to you and you know, feeling, I mean, it'd probably be coming to me too, based on that, but it would, there's, let's say they were following you after the event. How would you kind of prevent them or try to talk to them about getting help? If you
say, you know, I can speak to it from a cardiac standpoint for sure. Right. And I tell people all the time that, you know, our job is to use medications, use devices to try to get you back to be as fully functioning as possible. Sometimes that's not possible. And it, you know, and I think in those cases, those are the places where a good primary care doctor like Dr. Tyler is so important, right? You need somebody, patients need to feel like there's somebody that cares, that somebody that's there for them, that even though their lives are now different, that their lives are still meaningful, you know, and I tell them frequently to please to make sure they, you know, rely on their family as much as possible and not shut their family out. You know, and understand that, you know, life is, you know, meaningful life is not defined by somebody that, you know, it can do everything all the time, right? Meaning, certainly, I watch my son's favorite show on TV on Netflix is Beastmaster, right? And these, you know, this they do these amazing feats of strength and stuff. And I'm disabled compared to them, but that doesn't mean that, you know, my life is not meaningful. So, you know, it's a relative thing, I think, in terms of level of disability and meaning. And there's a lot of meaning to be derived even in folks that don't have necessarily, you know, 100% ability. So, you know, poor Senator Fetterman, who is obviously really struggling, and we certainly wish him well. You know, that's probably part of his struggle. Here was a very articulate gentleman who now, you know, has great difficulty articulating and speaking. And it's about trying to find, you know, different ways of doing it. I have a number of patients that are aphasic, but they're still completely cognitively intact and they're in there. And, you know, it's a matter of dealing with the frustration and using your family and your support and the people that love you to get you through those tough times.
Okay. So I have one of my other friends, her name is Dunia. She was a week. She and I talked about uterine fibroids, and we talk about how that can lead to anemia and everything that can go on. If somebody was going through that, we talked about the fact that if your hemoglobin is like 6 and 7, you talk about looking heart attack or a stroke and all. How would you tell that person, okay, yes, this is what's going on. You need to go and get help because all of that. So I'm talking about a cardiac point of view, that also cardio and gynecology together.
Yeah, no, I mean, yeah, depending on, depending on what other risk factors they have, you know, it's certainly very important to get a checkup to make sure that you're not ignoring, you know, a very important organ. So if you're having issues from a uterine standpoint, and actually the most common thing that I end up finding that's related, that's kind of gynecology related, ends up being you know, a shortness of breath that ends up being because of a hemoglobin of 6 and not because of, you know, some cardiac thing. So that's why for all the stress tests, we're supposed to, it doesn't always happen, but for every stress test, I do not like taking people in stress lab without knowing what their hemoglobin is, right? So sometimes the cure for somebody's shortness of breath is Dr. Tyler navigating them to the right place in terms of gynecology and dealing with their uterine fibroids and not, you know, doing some $1 million cardiac workup. So,
yeah, sometimes people who also have, we have seen patients before where, oh my God, every time I see my period, I pass out.
Yeah.
It's like, you're in your 20s. Let's not let that happen. I need you to go get checked.
Yeah, exactly right. Exactly right. Yeah, no, it's not normal. Yeah, no, you're exactly right. It's not, those things are not necessarily normal. And it's super important. I think, especially living in the US where, you know, we have, you know, cardiologists are a dime a dozen. It's easy to get checked out, I think, to make sure that passing out episode isn't something bad.
Okay, this person is asking, how does exercise help with heart problems?
Well, as long as you're safe to exercise, okay? So sometimes if you have a severe problem, you don't necessarily want to run out and do that. But for everyone who's listening, I think it's important to start some type of cardio exercise regimen because there's so many good benefits. From a heart standpoint specifically, okay, we know it helps people who have weak heart muscles to get stronger heart muscles. It also greatly, greatly helps the vasculature, right? The vessels. And then we know that exercise benefits those vessels. We also know that chronic exercise, will build accessory vessels, right? So that even if one vessel goes out, then you have, because you've been exercising so much, you have accessory vessels that will take over, all right? So cardio exercise is so important. And I don't think most of the population doesn't do it enough. I could certainly do more. It's so important. The general recommendation is 3 to 5 times a week, 30 minutes at a time, and try to get your heart rate up. You want your heart rate to be around, 70% of your peak heart rate. Your peak heart rate, if you say, is 220 minus your age, all right? So if you're 20 years old, your peak heart rate is 200. 70% of that is about 140, all right? So you want to get your heart rate up, 130, 140 beats a minute when you're exercising, all right? And you can, whatever. If you're 60, 220 minus 60 is 160. 70% of that is, 112. Yeah, 20% of that is 112 beats a minute. And so you want to be 112 to 120 beats a minute. So those are, those are your general, those are your general things that you want to do.
Okay. So, So, we'll both come from like immigrant backgrounds and all that too. So how, when you try to tell like certain people and just like me also, it's like, okay, why is it important to go? And if you haven't, a couple of years ago, we had, a friend who was a family member who was having chest pain all night, and he's a young person in his 30s, and he didn't go when he drove himself, and you saw people call 911, and plus people don't want to go. You have to pay so much money for them, ambulance, and all. By the time he got to the hospital, they did the EKG, they did everything, ultrasound, and his heart was completely blocked. By the time they got to the cath, lab, they couldn't, he didn't make it. So why is it important that when you start having chest pain and all that, and things to watch out for, to get to the hospital as quickly as possible, and don't just, because sometimes it's like, okay, I think I have GERD, reflux.
It's so important. It's hard to say. The heart is the most, I think the heart is probably one of the most important organs of the body, because it breaks down the most, right? And that's why heart disease is the number one killer. Starting at the age of like 40, heart disease is the number one killer, certainly in men. And it's scary. If you look at over the age of 80, there are 2 to 3 times as many women around as men, because all the men have died of heart attacks and strokes. And so it's so important for both men and women if they do have some chest symptoms, please make sure you get taken care of. If it's something mild, sure, call Dr. Tyler, go see her the next day, or call me, go see me the next day. If it's something severe, like, it's like bothering you and you're thinking about calling 911. If you're thinking about calling somebody because you're like, man, this really is not good, I do not feel well, you need to go get checked out in the ER, because you do not want to mess around with your heart. 50% of folks who have heart attacks on the outside don't make it. They do not make it to the hospital, okay? So the survivors that you see, I had a heart attack, I had a stent, all right? Do not assume that that is going to happen to you, right? So time is very important. As soon as you have some symptoms that you think are severe, you need to get into an ER to be seen and evaluated quickly to figure out whether there's a major problem or not, right? It doesn't necessarily mean that every time you have a runny nose, you have to rush to the ER. Or if you have, every time you have some mild heartburn, you have to rush to the ER, obviously. There's some judgment here. But for mild symptoms, please, even for mild symptoms, you should call and get checked out by your primary care doc or by your local cardiologist. But certainly for severe symptoms, things you're thinking about, you don't look good, you need to go to the ER, because if you mess around with the heart, you may not be around the next day to joke about it.
Okay. Can you, I don't know, I can't remember his name, Damien, that football player that got.
Oh, Dale Hamlin. Yeah.
Yeah. Can you just explain exactly what happened to him?
Yeah. It's such an interesting case, because we don't actually know exactly what happened. Dale Hamlin was a football player for the Buffalo Bills who participated in a routine tackle, a type of tackle that happens all the time. It wasn't particularly hard. And he suddenly collapsed. That collapse is due to an arrhythmia called ventricular tachycardia, or ventricular fibrillation, where the lower chambers of the heart go into a very disorganized rhythm. And if you're in that disorganized rhythm and you're beating real fast, you cannot get enough blood flow to your brain or any of the rest of your organs, and you collapse. And that's what happened to him. We don't know what exactly caused it. There was some suggestion that maybe the collision itself could have set it into a bad rhythm. Typically, that's called commotio cordis. Typically, that's seen with younger players with a baseball, right? A baseball is flung, a baseball is hit really hard. It hits a young player right in the center of the chest, and that sets off a bad rhythm, and the patient collapses. A lot of times may die unless they're very quickly defibrillated. Daryl Hamlin was not the similar situation. He was wearing pads. The hit wasn't a focal little thing. So the concern for Daryl Hamlin is that there's something going on with his heart underneath that makes him higher likelihood for this happening, right? And there's certain different cardiac conditions that can do that. And he's obviously getting $1 million workup, and or look, we're all waiting to see what it is he may have and whether or not he can play again. But at the end of the day, we don't know what exactly caused it, but we know that he had a bad rhythm that he went out of. And that bad rhythm, there's only one way to come out of that. You got to shock somebody to get out. So if you see somebody, and everyone who goes and sees and watches kids play or is part of some sporting event, this happens especially in males playing sports, all right? So somebody listening is probably going to experience this where someone collapses. When they collapse on a field, on an athletic field, do not assume that, oh, it's just someone fainting, it's no big deal. You have to run there, check to see if there's a pulse, check to see if they're responsive. If there is no pulse, you have to do two things. You have to tell somebody to call 911 right away, and then you have to start doing CPR right away. You have to start doing chest compressions right away, right? If we do nothing else on this 30-minute chat this morning, if you go to YouTube and look up CPR, how to do chest compressions, right? You can of course take courses and stuff, but if you don't get to that, just Google and YouTube it and see what chest compressions are like, because you may save someone's life. Because Daryl Hamlin's life was saved because somebody quickly started CPR, and of course somebody grabbed a defibrillator from the sidelines and was able to defibrillate him. By the way, Daryl Hamlin suffered from the same thing, same problem that many folks die with, unfortunately, whereas it took them a little while to recognize what was going on, right? He had collapsed. You know, in NFL, they're always worried about, oh, is it some spine thing, concussion, etc. In his case, there were some critical minutes that lapsed that maybe they could have done even sooner, right? I mean, they did a great job because he's obviously alive, but it could have been even better. And so everyone listening, if you see somebody drop, especially on an athletic football field, any athletic field, soccer, it doesn't matter, baseball, whatever. If somebody drops, you got to get to them, figure out if they're responding, figure out if there's a pulse, start CPR. So call somebody to go get a defibrillator and start CPR.
Okay. Now somebody watching would be like, oh, then if I want to play sports, does that mean I have to see a cardiologist and get a full workout because I'm a little scared now that something may happen to me?
Yeah. These are incredibly, incredibly rare events. So, I mean, I don't think every single person has to run and get a cardiac eval before they play sports. If you have risk factors, yes. If you're like 55 and you haven't played basketball for 15 years and now you're like, all right, I'm going to go play with the 30-year-olds, you may want to get checked out by someone, at least a primary care doctor, to do an EKG. You know, it's just common sense. But no, I mean, most people, the general rule is, you know, if you're a couch potato, don't suddenly start, don't try to run a marathon. You want to, you know, work into things. And if you get symptoms as you're working up to a level, then you want to stop, call a doctor.
Okay. One other thing that we talk about too, high blood pressure, you know, it's one of the most common cardiac ailments and all that too. Talk about high blood pressure and the importance of it and how to...
Yeah, high blood pressure is probably the most common cause of stroke, heart attack, and heart failure. So it is probably the most important thing to do screening-wise is to make sure you don't have severe hypertension and get that hypertension controlled at a young age. If you don't do that, then I think the chances of heart failure, heart attack, stroke, and kidney disease go way, 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 way up, all right? So there's way too many, especially in the Black community specifically. It's an epidemic of young Black men who have hypertension that's undiagnosed. And the only time it's diagnosed, because you don't feel high blood pressure. The first time you get diagnosed with high blood pressure is when you have a stroke or when you have a heart attack. So, so incredibly important for everyone. You know, I talked about not everyone needs to see a cardiologist before they start athletic activity, but everyone really needs to see a primary care doctor to make sure your pressure is not, you know, sky high and through the roof, right? So once a year, you should be seeing a good primary care doctor like Dr. Tyler.
So if you don't have any risk factors or just say mild risk factors and all that too, do you have to have a baseline EKG? Because I think I saw somewhere where there's a screening at least once a year to have baseline EKG. Or just something to start.
I'm a cardiologist. I'm a little biased. I know the family practice doctors think a little different than this, and they say, no, you don't need an EKG at all. Generally speaking, I think once you hit 45, I think it's not a bad idea, especially for a man, to get an EKG. And at those ages, men much greater than women have high rates of coronary issues. And so I think it's such a simple test. It's like $8, $12. I mean, I think it's a very, very worthwhile test to do. I know some of my medical colleagues disagree and think, oh no, we shouldn't do any EKGs unless you have some symptoms. I don't think it's a bad idea generally, especially for males. Because that age group, 45 to 65, is so, so key.
Okay, good. Let me just see if there's any more questions. Okay, so, okay, then it's a heart attack, heart failure, and cardiac arrest. Aren't they the same or different?
No, yeah, they're all very different. Heart attacks, happen because little blockages form in the arteries of the heart. There's different types of heart attacks. So, yeah, heart attacks refers to when heart muscle is dying. Heart failure generally refers to the heart not pumping well. Cardiac arrest refers to a bad arrhythmia where the heart just stops beating. So those are the three differences.
Okay, and as we discussed before, heart failure will keep you in and out of the hospital.
Yeah, exactly. So.
And we tell patients, making sure, I had a friend on last year, she was the CHF coordinator where I worked before. We talked about the importance of weighing yourself every morning, taking your medication like you're supposed to, calling your doctor when you start having shortness of breath, right. If you start gaining right. some weight, it's important to do that.
Right.
Okay, right. Let me see here. Stella Jeffries, I think she wanted to say, it's important to always get a baseline EKG. Okay, so she agrees with that too.
Yeah, good.
I see that because when I was reading my different, it's like, okay, yeah, most people are advocating for that now.
Yeah.
So, okay, also for men, I have some patients too where their blood pressure is very high and they want, medication for erectile dysfunction, and it's like a big thing. Why can't I get it? My blood pressure is okay. Please tell me, please explain why it's important to kind of hold off on any kind of medication for erectile dysfunction if you have really uncontrolled high blood pressure.
I mean, it's more that we would like to get your blood pressures under better control, because if you're doing strenuous physical activity with pressures that are sky high to begin with, then, I don't know. I'm not super excited. About doing strenuous activity during that, whether it be having sex or whether it be, running a marathon, right? You don't necessarily, or playing football or playing basketball, right? Or lifting weights even, because if your pressure starts out at 180 or 190, if you then do strenuous activity on top of that, it goes to 200, 220, that can be a significant strain to the heart that I'm not super excited about as a cardiologist. Now, if your numbers are 130, 140, 150, 140, 150, those are mild elevations, and that shouldn't be a reason why you can't get medication for erectile dysfunction. There are certain medicines that we use for blood pressure called clonidine specifically, the alpha blockers, doxazosin, terazosin. There are certain medicines that you don't want to use with Viagra or sildenafil or these PDE5 inhibitors that are used for erectile dysfunction. But outside of that, no. Yeah. So for severe hypertension, generally speaking, avoid strenuous activity. Mild hypertension, it's not the end of the world to get erectile ED meds for that.
So what somebody said, very, very much educational. Thank you, Henry.
If you leave blood pressure uncontrolled for a long time, that is a sure way to get impotence, by the way. So for the men out there.
Say that again so they can hear it.
Yeah, for the men out there, if your blood pressures are super high for a long time, what happens is, you will damage those fragile vessels over time, and over time it'll lead to impotence. So you want to control your blood pressures in a reasonable range in order to maintain yourself for your sex life for as long as you can. So men that have out of control pressures, number one, they may not be around because they may die of heart attack, and number two, even if they do survive and don't have heart attack or don't have a stroke, etc., then they'll eventually be impotent because those vessels cannot withstand those high pressures for a long time. Dr. Koka is an immigrant. Where is he from? I am from India. I was born in Delhi. I came here and I came here for schooling.
Okay. I guess this one is for the women now, yeah. But does using sex vibrators lead to?
I don't see why not. I mean, anything that is a stimulus, that is a stimulant, whether it be in a bad way, fear, or whether it be in a good way, it can certainly cause PVCs. I've never actually seen a case of that, but you'd have to, it'd be interesting. You'd have to do an EKG during that, or I guess you could feel it if you're having it. So yeah, that is possible.
And what does that feel like? In case
you will feel skipped extra beats. It's an uncomfortable feeling where you feel an extra beat. You'll feel a regular beat, and then suddenly you get a skip. And so sometimes patients will really feel that and don't feel well with that. Other patients have it all the time, and they have no idea that they're having it. But no question that anything that causes some type of excitement or stimulus or fear can cause PVCs.
Okay, we'll go to a preventative partner. So diet. For most of us, where I'm from, our staple is rice. And I know most Indian people have rice and all that too. And the first thing people say, don't tell me I'm not going to eat my rice. So I tell them like the healthy way to do stuff. So how would you dieting and all that? What would you tell your patients about eating healthy and all?
I'm agnostic towards what you do. I think our biggest problem is moderation. So I think trying to stay away from fatty foods is a good thing. Trying to stay away from red meats and not eating them every day is probably a good thing. But the major thing is honestly moderation. You know, we just eat, you know, in America, we're blessed in that we can buy a lot of food and we can eat a lot of it, right? I mean, the vast majority of the world, they just are not able to buy this quantity of food and consume it. And so that's why the majority of the world certainly doesn't deal with as many of these problems as we do. We have a massive obesity epidemic, and that obesity epidemic, you know, leads to diabetes, leads to heart disease, leads to kidney disease. And a lot of it starts from just consuming too much food. And so I'm honestly agnostic. So some people are keto, lean protein, I'm a big fan. Some people are Mediterranean, also a big fan. Some people are vegan, big fan of that too. I don't think there's one particular diet that's necessarily better than the other. I know there's a lot of diet people out there that are selling this and selling that, saying this is the diet that works, and this is, you know, buy my thing, and yeah, I'll show you. And you know, the liver king is running around. I don't know what he's doing. He's like eating raw this and raw that. And I think a lot of those are just a kind of a scam. Don't get conned into it. Don't spend your money on these stupid things. Just try to moderate what it is you eat and try to stay away from some of the bad things. Like, you know, consuming like 12 pounds of bacon every morning, probably not a good thing. So a lot of it is like, I think we just eat too much, you know, and if we can moderate what we eat, and I struggle with this too. If we can moderate what we eat, moderate our portions, that's the best thing you can do.
Okay, so I think we exhausted all the questions that somebody said. He's right, too much food is a problem for many people. So, and I think I got to all the questions and all that too. So, do you have any parting words, closing comments? And I just want to say thank you so much. Everybody loved you here. I can see the different comments. So, any parting words, closing comments that you can leave the audience with? Something really important that they can say, okay.
No, I think honestly, one of the greatest things in terms of long-term good health is healthy relationships, right? And that applies personally in having healthy personal relationships, right? Whether if your loved ones and eliminating those toxic people that we all know that you know, create a lot of toxicity and badness and bad health, but also healthy relationship with a doctor that you trust. So important, right? In these days, there's so little trust in institutions, right? And it's understandable. A lot of institutions have failed us, you know. A lot of ones that seem to be out for themselves, they're not doing. But there are, if you look hard enough and you use your network of good people, you will find good people. Dr. Tyler is a fantastic, great primary care physician that really loves her patients, and you can
Or
tell.
let me
And
just
she's
correct you first. I'm a nurse practitioner,
nurse
but that's still
practitioner.
gonna be writing.
Yeah, nurse
So.
practitioner. Yeah. No, I mean, but yeah, but you know, you're,
I
yeah.
think what you said
Anyway,
proper.
it's same thing. But my point is, you have to find people in the healthcare field that are good, that care about you. And I think that's a key. That's going to be a key to long-term health as well, right? Because just like you need a good plumber for your house to work, like can you imagine having a terrible plumber and using that terrible plumber all the time? A lot of times, and you can tell who the good plumbers are and who isn't. And your network of people that you have points you to who the good plumber is and who isn't, right? It's the same thing you have to do. Use your network, use the crowd to figure out Dr. Tyler's good, and find some good physicians that you trust and have faith in. And then put your faith in them, and maybe don't trust Dr. Google so much, because there's a lot of stuff that's on the internet. It's very hard to figure out what's right and what's wrong, and you really need the expertise of people like Dr. Tyler to sort out exactly, you know, exactly where, which direction to point
Okay. All right. Thank you so much. I really
in.
appreciate it. I know I was going to keep you for 30 minutes and people are asking questions and all that too.
No, no problem.
So
No problem.
thank you so much for coming on. Thank you
Okay.
also for the outside when, you know, when I call, I'm like,
Yeah.
okay, Dr. Coke,
No,
can you see this
anytime,
thing
anytime.
real
Always happy to
quick?
help.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you so much. And audience, thank you. If you have any more questions and all that, you just leave it
Oh,
there. We'll address it later on. And where can they find you if they want to
Yes,
contact
there's
you?
an email actually. If you can type it and put it on the screen or something, it's called myphillyheartdoc@gmail.com. So MyPhilly
Let me
heartdoc.
see. Let me just
MyPhillyheartdoc@gmail.com. There's also a website. My website is also, you know, if you Google MyPhilly Heart Doc, you will myphillyheartdoc.com. You will get our website as well. So myphillyheartdoc, all one word, .com. You'll get the website.
Okay, so let me do one second here. It's my glasses on. Let me just do this real quick. So
we can see my glasses on.
Yes. MyPhillyHeart.com, right?
MyPhillyHeartDoc.com.
Oh, MyPhillyHeartDoc. Okay.
Yeah. So that's the website. And then
MyPhillyHeart.com. Okay. So I think I need, okay.
If you go to that website, the email is right on the front page. So Philly Heart Doc or MyPhillyHeartDoc.com. Both of them work. Yep, that's correct. MyPhillyHeartDoc.com. That is correct. Mm-hmm. So, ready?
So we can do that. And okay.
Perfect.
MyPhillyHeart.com. So all okay. Right. So let's see you. All righty. So thank you all for watching and thank you for coming by. Thank you, Dr. Luca. I'll talk to you guys later. Okay.
Good night.
Bye. Alrighty.
Bye. Bye.
I'm just gonna make my closing statements.
Yeah. Go ahead. Sorry.
Alrighty. Okay. So for those of you who watched tonight, please, you know, share the show. If you haven't liked and joined Abby Tyler's Healthy Living page, I'm on Facebook and I'm also on YouTube. Thank you all for watching. For those of you who will be watching later, I say thank you as well. And thanks again to Dr. Cooker for stopping by. And I'll see you guys next Tuesday. Okay. Good night and good luck. Bye-bye.